Hi, welcome to Granite State Outdoors. In today's show, we'll hit some trout streams and share a recipe for your prized catch. See how biologists are bringing back a popular game bird to New England, and then join us as we go in search of New Hampshire's walleye. These stories and more all up next on GSO.
Fishing one of New Hampshire's premier streams, Diane Matott investigates today's conditions.
It says that it's 48 degrees. The water temperature is really cold today. So what we gotta do is try to hit these guys right on the nose with a nymph. That's the only way they're gonna move. This is the nymph that we're gonna be putting on. It's called a copper john. It's got a bead head on it.
Select a fly that you're confident with and try to match the size and color of the insects in the stream. Pinching your barbs means easier release and more fishing time in New Hampshire.
Here is our dropper. This is our indicator. And then right here is our dropper.
New Hampshire's trout often position themselves in and along the current while feeding.
There's so much structure in this river that it's fantastic that we're able to hit a lot of the pools. There are fish in a beautiful brook like this. They are going to become opportunists. Any twist or turn in that dry fly, you just want to be ready to set the hook. Doesn't matter where you go in New Hampshire, you're going to find a brook just like this. This is great territory for the brook trout. For the water temperature, the rock structure, and they're a beautiful, beautiful fish to catch. Here we go. Now we got a pool. Nice deep pool. Whoa! Isn't that beautiful waterfall? Here we're casting the nymph straight up in front of us. You want to just pull the line in gently as fast as it's coming downstream.
Be quick with the hook set.
Fish the back of the pool first. Here we have us a brown. Let's see if we can catch another species out of here. Another! Woohoo!
New Hampshire streams are loaded with many different trout species.
A beautiful rainbow. Let him go. There he goes.
All right, here.
Nice salmon.
Right, I'm coming up real fast here. Again, got nice light pressure. It's this year's stock of fish.
The landlocked salmon has been sought by anglers in New Hampshire for close to 140 years. A big part of its history has been the people who have watched over this fishery and still do. Today, biologists and volunteers are marking salmon at the Powder Mill Fish Hatchery in New Durham, New Hampshire.
This is an annual rite of spring for us. This is clipping the landlocked salmon that we stock every spring into the large lakes. Basically, this marks this population of fish this year as to a certain time frame being stocked. This dates back to probably, I would say, the early 40s, mid-40s.
Much better than
tonight. More precious than the prospector's hard-won riches is the hoard of living gold taken from the vault of a female landlocked salmon. Why are these eggs more precious than gold? In the whole wide world, you will find only a handful of lakes and streams nestled close together on our own continent, which can boast of landlocked salmon fishing today. And right at the heart of this area lies New Hampshire, excelled by none as a place to fish for this prize quarry.
Without management, the survival of popular New Hampshire salmon fisheries would be short-lived. It's as true today as it was a half a century ago. A film from the early 50s captures this recurring New Hampshire tradition.
Each year on opening day, every available parking spot near an area of open water is crowded with trailers and boats of every description. More and more fishermen show up with all sorts of equipment, and if they don't have what it takes, they will buy it.
Opening day traffic jams still take place today as the anglers head out in search of open water to fish, braving more than just frigid temperatures.
But the glory years for me for salmon fishing were the late 50s into the 60s and into even 1975. I caught my biggest salmon of all out of Squam Lake. And that one there was 11 1/4 pounds and it was 32 inches long. There's no better lake right now than Winnipesaukee. They did an outstanding job with this lake. Unbelievable. I consider this a trophy salmon lake now. The way this is, it's a trophy salmon lake. You know?
It's an intense fishery. Years ago, before the advent of fish finders, downriggers, salmon would typically be caught until the end of June, and then again during the month of September. But now, with downriggers and whatnot, you can fish for salmon successfully right through the dead of summer.
What follows is the story of just one phase of the New Hampshire Fish and Game Department's effort to make their state a fisherman's paradise.
We have some wild reproduction in the lake. But it would be so small that your catch rates would sink almost to zero. You could go out there literally for days on end without ever seeing a salmon. So we keep the population of salmon high by restocking fish every year.
As they did in the early 50s, biologists still capture salmon on their spawning runs to keep the fishery strong. Egg-laden female salmon are stripped of their eggs. Male salmon, or jacks, are milked, fertilizing the eggs before they're transferred to the hatchery. What may have taken weeks for the fish to accomplish on their own is completed in moments with a gentle stroke.
Although the eggs are tender, they can be safely transported for the next few hours in insulated boxes. They are loaded into a pickup and rushed to the New Hampton hatchery without delay. Jars of eggs are placed in the hatching trough to bring the temperature of the eggs gradually to that of the hatchery water.
For over 30 years, Harry Tudor has been at the Powder Mill Hatchery in New Durham, New Hampshire, where the landlocked salmon are now hatched and raised. Over that time, he's seen a lot of changes.
We used to have wooden troughs and never had the incubators where you had to put baskets, put the eggs in little baskets in the wooden troughs where the water was flowing through. And we had to keep them covered over with shades. But now, they've done away with the wooden troughs and we've got the incubators which are naturally shaded.
With the same loving care a mother devotes to mixing the formula for her newborn baby, the fish culturist prepares the first meal for his tiny charges. These are critical days.
The diet of all the fish has changed. We used to feed ground up beef liver and it was pretty messy to work with. And the fish didn't do as well with it as they do now with the drier foods, grains.
An important part of the salmon's success in New Hampshire is freshwater smelt.
Smelt are critical forage for our landlocked salmon. Forage meaning basically what the fish eat.
Smelt population is very high, so we can stock pretty much a full complement of salmon. Some lakes that aren't doing too well, we stock very few salmon in them because these fish require a lot of food and they can really do damage to what's remaining in the lake.
For salmon lakes that need a boost, biologists deliver smelt eggs that were captured on burlap strips from other areas where salmon or brook trout are not stocked. These smelt eggs will eventually hatch, increasing the forage base for salmon.
John, we're going to start at that end and try to get it to lay flat and work it right back to the tail end.
It's really about balancing the predator-prey relationship. And if you don't do that, you really get poor growth rates and the quality of fish deteriorates.
Living Gold, produced by nature, assisted by man, brings you landlocked salmon fishing in New Hampshire second to none. When you tie into one of those big battling tackle busters, don't lay it to fisherman's luck alone.
That's a little salmon, a small one. We want a 6-pound salmon, is what we want.
They do grow, you know, quite rapidly. And I have hooked into a 5-pound salmon on a fly pole, and it is fun.
Better game fish, a lot of action.
3 to 4 pounds are real nice salmon. You get anything 5+, that's a biggie. But usually you can get something 3-4 pounds. They're real fat, they're nice fish.
Today we caught a nice one. We caught 5 today. Let most of them go.
Yep.
There's a nice one. Gonna be a nice dinner tonight.
And apparently that other line had enough action on it that we end up with both the fish. Well, there's a catch for you. How often does that happen?
Hi, I'm Dave Caron, the chef at the Rainbow Grill at Tall Timber Lodge in Pittsburgh, New Hampshire. Tonight we're doing trout almondine, so let's get started. To start, we're going to make an almond flour. So we take sliced almonds, put them in a food processor, and we're going to pulverize these until they're just very fine, like a flour. So now the almonds are ground fine enough, and we're going to take a 1/2 cup of just regular flour and add that. And we're going to grind it some more just to blend the two. Now we're going to add another 1/2 cup of almonds, and we're going to grind those up about halfway just to give the flour some texture. So now the almonds are about half ground. So we're going to dredge the trout in the finished flour, but before we do that, we want to add some just sliced almonds on top of the flour, because when we put the trout in this flour, that's going to stick first, and it's going to make the trout look really nice as it cooks. So I take the trout, it's been washed and dried, and we just take it and press it into the flour and then flip it over. And if there's some spots that the flour didn't quite attach, you can just take the flour and drizzle it over it. And that's what it should look like when it's done flouring. We're going to cook the trout in 4 tablespoons of butter. I use a non-stick pan. If you're going to do this recipe, you have to use non-stick. So we put the 4 tablespoons of butter in. Just make sure you get all the butter melted. And I like to cook trout on medium heat. And once the butter's melted, you take the fish, and if there's any excess flour on the fish, just shake it a little bit, because that excess flour, if you left it on, it would burn. So then you add it to the pan. It's going to take about 7 total minutes to cook, about 6 minutes on this side, and then I squeeze some lemon on it and flip it over for about a minute. You can see the trout's really cooking nicely, and on the edges it's beginning to brown on the sides. When it has about a minute left, I'll take a wedge of lemon and squeeze it over the top of the fish. You'll notice that after the lemon goes in, it really starts to bubble up. That's actually going to help brown the fish a little bit. Then we'll look again to see if it's browning, and it is quite nicely. So I'm going to go ahead and flip it. Now about another minute, and then I'll check it to see if it's cooked. We'll see if it breaks, and it does break. The flesh is nice and white when it breaks through like that. And if you just lay it back down, it goes back to retain its form. And now we're going to make the sauce. So after you take the fish out of the pan, you clean the pan out, wait maybe like 30 seconds or so on high heat, just to let the pan get nice and hot. And then you add approximately about an eighth of a cup of Frangelico, and then you flame it. After the flames subside, you can add 3 tablespoons of butter. And then while the sauce is cooking, you want to make sure you keep stirring the pan. Wait until all the butter melts. Probably want to reduce it about halfway, and it gets nice and thick, and it's going to coat the fish really nice. And as you shake it, you can see that it's getting nice and thick. So after the sauce is reduced by half and it's nice and thick, then you just take and coat it all over the fish, and it always makes the fish really look great for a presentation. So here's the Rainbow Grove Trout Almondine. I'd love to cook some for you, so come on up to Tall Timber Lodge in Pittsburgh, New Hampshire. We hope to see you soon.
Getting information on hunting, fishing, and New Hampshire's wildlife is easy. Just log on to the New Hampshire Fish and Game website at wildnh.com.
What does cutting trees have to do with bringing woodcock back to New England? Everything.
Woodcock are a very important part of biodiversity because the types of habitats that woodcock occupy represent the same types of habitats that a whole suite of species occupy. Woodcock are what we term an umbrella species. Because their habitat needs are specific enough, they can represent other species that have similar habitat needs.
Across the Atlantic Flyway, which extends from the tip of Florida through New England into Canada, an initiative is underway to stop the decline of the timberdoodle, also known as North American woodcock. One of the best ways to achieve that goal is through land management.
There are 23 partners on the Northern Forest Woodcock Initiative. Those partnerships range from private landowners to Department of Defense to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. And one of our best partners is the Natural Resources Conservation Service, the NRCS.
With coordination by the Wildlife Management Institute, a massive land makeover program is unfolding across the region.
Now we needed to keep the stumps up a little bit. You see how it shakes the stump?
Kevin Evans is checking in on one of the projects. He's director of College Woodlands for the second college grant in New Hampshire.
It's a township owned by Dartmouth College, just a little north of Erroll, New Hampshire. The significance of this area is that this is a great riparian area along the Swift Diamond River. Kind of a unique area for a couple of different kinds of management. One of the things you'll see here on the grant, which is maybe a little different than some other areas, is that our woodcock like to be in alder. We have very little aspen, and so most of our woodcock is spending their time in alder flats. The way that we have been regenerating our alder is using a machine called the brontosaurus. We go in and mow the alder, trying to create some type of an opening where the alder will come back and regenerate itself very vigorously so that we don't get any growth on the forest floor.
So far, the work at Second College Grant is paying off.
We started the habitat improvement program about 7 years ago. At that time, we had about 25 singing males on the property. After working for about 3 or 4 years on habitat manipulation, we now have about 52 singing males on the property.
Sportsmen and women that use Second College Grant for hunting woodcock have also been pleased with the improvement of the woodcock population.
People that come here on the grant are starting to give us positive messages that, you know, the habitat that we're creating is working, and they're starting to, you know, see populations increase themselves.
Coop. Dibbert.
It's not only on Second College Grant that sportsmen and women have seen increased numbers of woodcock, but also places like the Ethan Allen Firing Range in Vermont. Today, Dan McCauley is trying his luck at pursuing this acrobatic game bird.
Good girl, Dana.
Nice adult female here.
For Dan, hunting is just part of his passion for woodcock. Through his work with the U.S. Geological Survey, he helps with management of the bird.
We're here on the Ethan Allen Firing Range in Jericho, Vermont. The National Guard is a cooperator on our research and management study of American woodcock. It's predominantly an older forest, a mature forest, but they've got a lot of good alder covers that are on the bottomlands along the rivers and lowlands of the area. And as part of being a good steward for wildlife, they're cooperating with the Wildlife Management Institute and this initiative to try and improve the habitat for woodcock. Part of that is to do cutting and rejuvenation of alder covers. It actually has a nitrogen fixing quality to the root, so it enriches the soil and makes it better. And earthworms are found in the soils around alders, and that's the primary food of woodcock. So that's one of the reasons we emphasize alder management for woodcock.
Part of managing the woodcock population is monitoring them by capturing the birds for banding.
We do night capture of woodcock to gain a better index. It's a type of monitoring, but to gain a better index of what the population is doing. The reason we use night capture is because it's very efficient. On a good rainy night where the capture conditions are right, we can catch 20 to 30 birds in one night's work. When we capture birds, we band them, and through the return of those bands, we can tell where the woodcock go and get an idea about mortality. But probably more importantly with the banding work is that when we capture a woodcock, we age and sex it. And if we capture a sufficient sample size, then we can show the productivity of the birds that we're working with.
Through initiatives like this, taking place up and down the Atlantic Flyway, North American woodcock populations are beginning to show improvement. But there's more.
It's not just woodcock management, really. We want to emphasize that, you know, it's an early successional habitat, and there's a lot of species that benefit from the things that we're trying to get done.
Hi, I'm Mark Beauchamp with New Hampshire Fishing Game. I'm with fisheries biologist Gabe Grease, and we're targeting walleye.
It's mid-spring in New Hampshire. We're along the Connecticut River at the mouth of the Cold River where it joins the Connecticut River. This is an area where the walleye will come in and rest as they're moving their way up the river to spawn. Probably the most versatile lure that I use in my tackle box is curl-tail grub with a ball head jig.
So I got a 3/8 ounce jig head because the main Connecticut River's up a little bit today. I'm just tipping it with a live shiner. And then I just took a piece off of another grub, just tore a piece off. What I'm gonna use that for is to try to keep that shiner on that hook a little bit longer.
What's the walleye's typical diet?
Typical diet is fish. What species of fish they eat depends on what water body they're in, what's available for bait fish. Connecticut River, primarily talking spot-tail shiners, golden shiners, yellow perch. Walleyes are widely known as fish-eating machines. Walleye between 16 and 18 inches have to be returned to the water. Can't keep any of them. You can still keep one walleye over 18 inches and three under 16, or you could keep four walleye under 16 inches. And the purpose of that is to protect those 16 to 18 inch fish, which are good in terms of their ability to produce a lot of eggs for the females. They're prime fish, yet at the same time, we want to thin out those big populations of smaller fish a little bit.
And that's what we came here for. Beautiful New Hampshire walleye. There's that eye. Look how big that is, Gabe. That's huge.
That's fantastic. Look at the teeth, too. You can see why I was saying before how they eat fish like nobody's business.
Yeah, but you know the take was so subtle. Look at that fish.
Yep.
It's beautiful in the sun.
Yep.
Here's the other deal with these guys is they get this really sharp preopercular. Is that what
yep.
they call that?
Yep. And one of the fantastic things about walleye, everybody talks about how good the fillets are. The cheek of these fish is like a scallop.
It
is absolutely beautiful and just it tastes so good.
Let's put him back. I'm gonna just put my hand behind him. Give him a little bit of a revive. Oh, there he goes. Beautiful.
Nice.
All right.
Oh yeah. That's a nice fish. Come on. That's a nice female from the looks of it.
19 and a half.
Give me 20, come on.
20.
Thanks for watching Granite State Outdoors. I'm John Charpentier for New Hampshire Fish and Game. See you next time on GSO.